Welcome, everybody. Thanks for joining. My name is Henry. I work in the field HR, Human Resources Department, at Doctors Without Borders, or Médecins Sans Frontières. We're best known by our French acronym, MSF, so you'll be hearing us use that throughout the presentation this evening. I'm here with Doug Mercer, who will be presenting tonight, and Erlyn File from Portland. She's a Portland-based midwife, an MSF aid worker, and currently sits on our board of directors. She will share personal stories and insights gained from several MSF field assignments. Before we start, I just want to touch on a couple of technical matters. The audio through your speakers or the telephone. Please keep the information about how to tune in available in case you get bumped out and need to log back in. This presentation will last 90 minutes, so you may want to use your speakerphone if that's available. We will discuss several things tonight. In particular, here's the format. If you see there, we'll take some questions at the end. So please save your questions and make sure to ask them in the question box in your control panel. Now I'd like to introduce our presenters, starting with Doug.
Hi, everybody. Welcome. Thanks for joining us. As you see, my name is Douglas Mercer. I'm the Field HR Recruitment Coordinator. I plan and coordinate a lot of recruitment outreach events across the country in order to find skilled individuals like yourselves to apply and hopefully become field workers for MSF. I've been with MSF since 2008, mostly working in our headquarters office in New York in field human resources as a recruiter. In 2010, I was lucky enough to do a field mission to Haiti. So after the earthquake, there was later that year in 2010, there was quite a large cholera outbreak in Port-au-Prince and the surrounding areas, and I went down there to do some local recruiting and support. After that, I got married and I had two kids, and now I've got two beautiful daughters, but I'm sort of patiently waiting for them to grow up so that I can get back to the field again soon. Erlyn?
Yeah, my name is Erlyn File. I'm a CPM, so I'm a certified professional midwife. I've done 6 missions with MSF, 3 in South Sudan, 2 in Ethiopia, and my last mission was in Papua New Guinea. I now serve on the board of directors.
Great. Welcome. Thanks for being here.
So we're going to start with just a quick video. This is a short 2-minute video that gives you an overview of MSF and some background. And then after the video, I'll come back and talk in more detail about some of these points.
Doctors Without Borders, also known internationally by our French name, Médecins Sans Frontières, or MSF, is an independent medical humanitarian organization. Founded in 1971, MSF won the Nobel Peace Prize in 1999. Today we have some 33,000 staff on the ground in roughly 70 countries. We work in communities affected by war, natural disasters, disease outbreaks, chronic neglect, and other crises. We treat people based on medical needs alone, regardless of race, religion, or political affiliation. On any given day, we assist patients who have no other access to healthcare services. Our medical teams can offer critical services such as surgery, maternal care, vaccinations, and mental health counseling. When people are forced from their homes, we focus on treating illnesses and injuries. We work to prevent disease outbreaks in refugee camps and other settlements. We treat malnutrition and the consequences of sexual violence. Our advocacy message is always the same. People at risk should be able to access health care, and medical workers, even in active conflict zones, must be able to provide it. that life-saving medicines and vaccines must be affordable and accessible to the people who need them most. The ongoing support of our donors, together with the profound commitment of our aid workers, will allow MSF to provide independent and impartial assistance to people in crises for a long time to come. We know that the future holds many challenges for people around the world, but we also know what's possible when we go where we're most needed with the materials we need to deliver life-saving medical care.
So let me start by just telling you a little bit about ourselves and who we are. So what is Doctors Without Borders? You heard this in the film. Doctors Without Borders officially were an international independent medical humanitarian aid organization who provides emergency assistance to populations in distress from armed conflict to epidemics to natural disasters. So, as you also heard in the film, originally founded in 1971, it was actually in the wake of what's called the Biafra crisis. This was a situation in Nigeria in 1971 where the Nigerian government was basically starving a portion of its own population. The International Committee of the Red Cross was there at the time trying to help the Biafra people, the ICRC. And there were three French doctors, so the story goes, there were three French doctors who were working for ICRC, felt compelled to speak out or bear witness about the atrocities they were witnessing to the Biafra people. Now, under the Red Cross mandate, they weren't allowed to do so. So they split off from the Red Cross along with a group of French journalists back in Paris, and they formed Médecins Sans Frontières. So that was 1971, originally a split off from the Red Cross. This is our charter. MSF can be quite a complex organization. There are lots of different cultures, lots of different sections, lots of different ways of working, different languages. It's really our charter that binds us all together. I myself come back to the charter all the time to remind myself why I'm here. If you're interested in joining MSF and becoming a field worker, I suggest you start by reading the charter. See if your own personal principles align with the principles of MSF. And you see some of the principles here. The core principles are underlined in red. I'm going to go through just a few of them that I think are really important. The first core principle of MSF is independence. And for me, it's a really important one. It's what attracts a lot of people to MSF. It's what distinguishes us, I think. What it means for me is independence from any other agenda aside from the medical one. So independence from economic agendas, independence from political affiliations, independent from religious powers. It's the medical programming that's the core focus of what we do. It's this kind of independence that enables us to work in the really complex situations and places that like we do, like in Pakistan, for example. This is the this is in the Swat Valley near the Afghan border. So I have a colleague in New York who recently did a training, came back from a training in Pakistan. He was only there for 2 weeks, but he said he was asked four times, oh, you're with MSF? Where does your money come from? So MSF, so independence is also financial independence. Yeah, so you see here, this is a chart of funding by contributions by source in 2016. You can see this is, we call it movement-wide or worldwide MSF, 95% of our contributions came from private sources worldwide. So individuals, corporations, and foundations. MSF is over $1 billion organization these days. Here in the US, we raise about, don't quote me on this, it's 350 to about 400, it's probably up to about $400 million a year we raise. It's 100% from private sources here in the US. So we don't take money from government agencies, we don't take money from pharmaceutical companies, we don't take money from arms companies, tobacco companies. It's 100% in the US from private sources, mostly private individuals, a few carefully vetted corporations and foundations. Again, this is what enables us, gives us the freedom to work in the places that we do. Neutrality, another staple and pillar of MSF. For me, it really is simple. It means we don't take sides. So on the ground, in the field, working in complex situations like in Yemen, or like in Eastern Congo, for example, there are a lot of different parties that we have to work with. In Eastern Congo, we have many different projects running at the same time, and we're doing negotiations with the Hutu militia and the Tutsi militias and the Mai Mai militias, the Congolese military itself, the other local actors in the area. And it's imperative that in all of these communications and all of these negotiations, we remain neutral to preserve the security and the medical quality of our programs that we have running in that country. Impartiality, another principle of MSF. And what it means is that we treat everybody. We're impartial in who we treat. So regardless of race, regardless of ethnicity, regardless of political affiliation or religion or economics, we treat military and rebels and Taliban sometimes all under the same roof in the same compound at the same time. We base our medical assistance on the needs. So those that are the most sick, those that are the most injured, they will receive priority. You see here also, I like this photo from Central African Republic, the sort of famous no weapons sign. You see this everywhere at MSF. We have it on our gates, we have them on our compounds, stickers on our vehicles. MSF has a strict no weapons policy. This is part of our security and the part of the way we do security. All of our guards are unarmed guards. And the way it works is if you have a weapon, you're not allowed to bring a weapon into any of our compounds or facilities, so you would need to check that weapon. It really enables us to create a safe working zone around our compounds, around our facilities, so that we can treat patients impartially. Medical ethics and innovation, yeah, a big part of what we do. You know, every day trying to provide the best quality medical care that we can. Constantly asking ourselves what is medically possible and what is not medically possible in the field. Constantly challenging ourselves to be innovative, constantly challenging others, like the WHO, for example, to update and innovate their protocols. MSF, for example, was innovative with the use, very innovative with the use of ARV drugs for HIV/AIDS patients in the field some years ago. Innovative in the use of inflatable hospital tents, inflatable OR theaters that we used in the Sri Lankan war and after the Haiti earthquake and today in Syria, innovated with the use of the cholera vaccine in Haiti, examples like this. And advocacy, one of the top core principles of MSF. And this is, as I said, one of the reasons why MSF was founded in the first place. We say speaking out, we call it témoignage or bearing witness. It takes on many, many different forms of advocacy. This was an example of, this was the former MSF International President James Orbinski, who was accepting the Nobel Peace Prize in Norway in 1999. So during this acceptance speech, Dr. Orbinski called for the stopping of the indiscriminate bombing of civilians in Chechnya at the time. And he was criticized during the speech, actually, for not being neutral. The reality was that MSF wasn't, by him calling out, we weren't being anti-Russian or pro-Chechenian. We saw the indiscriminate bombing of civilians in Chechnya as a public health crisis. And what Dr. Orbinski was doing was advocating and trying to bring awareness to the public health crisis at the time. So it wasn't that he wasn't being neutral. He was advocating. And it takes on many different forms, like I said, printed publications, press releases, press conferences. We have an interesting advocacy unit in our office in New York. It's called the Access to Essential Medicine Campaign. They advocate essentially with the US government and with big pharmaceutical companies for reduced costs for essential medicines. Advocacy can also be events, for example. We have this touring, traveling exhibit event called Force from Home that was touring the East Coast last fall and will be touring the West Coast this fall. It's a simulated refugee camp experience exhibit, and its purpose is to advocate for the awareness of the refugee crisis today, of the 65 million people who are displaced from their homes today. So advocacy, though, can also be just you and me discussing the issues. The important thing for MSF is that the conversation remains about access to the patients, that it's about preserving that humanitarian corridor, and of course, speaking out against any violations of the Geneva Convention. Okay, So where do we work? So this was a map of where we were last year in 2016. This map is constantly changing though, right? Because we're all constantly opening and closing projects in different countries. At any given time, we're between 60 and 70 countries in the world. You see 58% of our programs were in Africa, mostly sub-Saharan Africa. That number's come down quite a bit over the last few years. I remember it was much higher and more of our programs were in Africa, but as of late, our presence in the Middle East and in Asia has been growing. 56% unstable contacts, 44% stable contacts is a little bit of a misleading statistic, I think. You could be working, for example, in a quote-unquote stable context, and war could break out at any time, or some sort of internal instability at any time, which would then make it an unstable project. So I like to say that potentially everything that we do is potentially an unstable context. The most interesting stat here for me is the last one. Of the 32,000 field positions, 83% of them are locally hired staff. We call them national staff. So these are the local staff, the doctors, nurses, their administrators, their mental health officers, pharmacists as well. They're also cooks, cleaners, drivers, security guards. This is really the backbone of the organization. We, the international staff, are there as visitors in their country. We're usually there in a training or a teaching capacity, but I can tell you from experience, and I'm sure Erlyn will as well, it usually ends up going both ways. You end up learning just as much, if not more, from your national staff as they do from you. And at the end of the day, at the end of 9 to 12 months, we get to go home and they continue to stay in their country to fight whatever the public health crisis is. Some other statistics, sometimes people ask about some HR statistics. You know, it's remarkably, it's been 50% men, 50% women in the field for many years. It's usually pretty balanced in the individual projects. Average age at MSF is overall, I believe, is 39. The average age of Americans is a little older. It's about 44 right now, and that's because we have quite a large pool of retired surgeons here in the U.S. But it really ranges in terms of age. There are a lot of people come to MSF ready to make a career right out of residency, and then there are a lot of people who have, say, had a private practice for many years, and now they're in their 60s, and they're looking to go to the field at that point. So there is no minimum age, and there is no maximum age either. This is just a snapshot from 2015 activity highlights. It gives you just a kind of sense of the scope of the work that we do. You see right in the middle column, we have 219,300 births assisted in 2015. That includes cesarean sections. C-sections are the largest surgery that we do. We do more C-sections than any other surgery in the field. You can quickly see just 8 million outpatient consultations, 1.5 million people vaccinated against measles, 333 HIV patients registered. It gives you some sense of scope. Okay, so quickly I'm just going to talk to you about where we work when we intervene. So armed conflict. Armed conflict is the biggest reason why MSF may intervene and open a program in a particular spot. Over 50% of our projects are in armed conflict or post-conflict zones. So of course we do trauma surgery in armed conflict zones. This is an example of, this is one of the inflatable OR tents that I was talking about. In Syria in 2013, this is an anesthesiologist treating a gunshot wound. But we also do basic primary health care in armed conflict zones as well. Epidemic response, another big reason why we may respond and intervene. Everybody probably knows what this is a photo of. This was Ebola in Guinea in 2014. Ebola brought us a lot of awareness, a lot of attention in the press, a lot of fundraising. But of course, MSF responds to a number of different epidemic outbreaks, malaria, measles, meningitis, yellow fever, cholera. I can give you some more statistics. I remember in 2010, we launched a measles vaccination campaign in Malawi. We vaccinated 4 million people in 4 months in Malawi. And on a slightly different scale, I remember just last year, maybe it was earlier this year, there was a yellow fever outbreak that started in Angola. And I think a yellow fever, technically a yellow fever outbreak is one case, but there were a few cases that spread into southern Congo. We launched a campaign in southern Congo, and we vaccinated 750,000 people in 2 weeks. So that was the largest scale vaccination in such a short time frame that we've ever done. So epidemic response is a big part of what we do. Malnutrition. So together, armed conflict, epidemics, and malnutrition make up 90% of our programming. And usually they're all intertwined together, right? So like in a place like Chad. It was actually Chad was where we, MSF first instituted a revolutionary new therapeutic feeding protocol, which some of you may know. You can see it here in the photo. The lady in the yellow scarf is holding it in her hands. It's a ready-to-use food called Plumpy Nut. It's actually a peanut paste solution, a nutritious peanut paste solution. So, say 15 years ago, malnourished children, along with their mothers, would have to be admitted into an MSF hospital on an inpatient basis. Then, with the advent of Plumpy Nut, it means we could start treating children on an outpatient basis. And the difference is we could go from treating hundreds of children per week to tens of thousands of children per week for malnutrition. So, again, another example of MSF being innovative in the field. Yeah, and the last reason we might intervene in a country and start programs is natural disasters. Natural disasters, everybody remembers, this is the earthquake in Haiti in 2010. More recently, I remember the cyclone in the Philippines in 2013. We responded also to the earthquake in Nepal, you remember, I think that was 2015. Again, it brings us a lot of attention, a lot of awareness, a lot of fundraising, natural disasters, but it's really a small part of what we do. It's only 5 to 10% of our programming. Of course, we do it very well. The reason is we're an emergency response organization, and we have emergency pools of aid workers, emergency pools of funding, emergency pools of logistics standing by at all times. So, this is the way we work. I remember in 2015 when the Nepal earthquake hit, a lot of smaller NGOs, the earthquake hits, they have to go out and raise funds in order to open a program in Nepal to respond. Or they have to go out and recruit field workers to open a program to respond in Nepal. I had many recruitment agencies calling me and saying, oh, we have people, we can help you find people. And I was in the fortunate position of saying, no thanks, we have a ready-to-go emergency standby pool of aid workers who can respond as soon as the natural disaster occurs or as soon as the epidemic outbreaks. This ensures that we're the first responder and first boots on the ground. I think that's it for now. That gives you a kind of overview of MSF. We're going to get into some of the midwife stuff now, so I'm going to turn it over to Erin. Yeah. It's not here, though. Your stuff's not here. Sorry.
So my name is Erlyn, and I started off with MSF in South Sudan, and I'm just going to talk a little bit about life in the field. So living in the field and the experiences that I've had, one of the things is that it's incredibly hot. So you can see that it is 50 degrees Celsius, over 50 degrees
Whoa.
Celsius. So in this project, we often had weather that was 130 degrees in the shade. And imagine then you're working in the hospital delivering babies in that environment. So some of the living situations that you might be in, this on the left-hand side is inside of one of my tubos. So you see you have a bed and a pillow and a box to put your personal things in. And on the right-hand side, in the top, is an overview of the compound. In a particular project in South Sudan, you can barely see the Nile River in the background. And then on the bottom left, different tukuls and our kind of hangout hammock space.
Yes, quirky.
Food, often a big question. In the top left-hand side, this is salad and fish from when I was in Papua New Guinea. The food that we had there was amazing. And then next to that on the right-hand side, We are in the market getting milk so that we can make our own yogurt. More typically, you see our spaghetti cake at the bottom on the left-hand side and some canned corn and fresh vegetables. It's common also in the field for every couple of weeks for food to be delivered to compensate for what can't be found in the local market. So here we have our flight bringing in eggs. Again, it can be really hot. This was when I was in Ethiopia, the desert. Also, the rainy season, digging out the vehicle from mud when I was on an outreach project. And then again in Papua New Guinea, it's the monsoon season, and instead of going through the mud, we're going through a river of water. So it can be a little hard sometimes to reach your patients, and it can be a little challenging to be in these more rugged and rough living conditions. It's also quite an adventure. Papua New Guinea, we went sailing every weekend.
Nice.
It was really wonderful. This was when I was working in a sexual and gender-based violence project, so the contrast between the patients every day and sailing on the weekends was interesting to contemplate. And one of the biggest things that is challenging about working in the field, but also one of the biggest blessings in being with MSF, are the people that you meet and the teammates that you have. So this is myself and three of the midwives that I spent 9 months working with in Ethiopia. Cool. And here is another group of team members. We had just put out a fire at the compound across the street and proceeded to get in a water fight and clean ourselves off. So we're having a good time, even though we had just dealt with an intense situation, which is pretty common in the field. So I also want to talk a little bit about working as a midwife for MSF. There are a variety of projects that you might be in. So this is a hospital that was run by the Ministry of Health. And you can see on the right-hand side, we've put tarps down on the side of the building because it was just open screens. We would get these intense dust storms that would blow sand all over our laboring mothers. And in the windstorms, the tarps sometimes would flap all the way up and then come crashing down. It's an interesting environment to deliver babies in. The labor and delivery room was very, very small and very hot. But not too untypical of MSF. This is inside of a larger hospital, one that we built ourselves. And I know Doug mentioned earlier the blow-up tents or the blow-up hospital. So this is, in the background, the maternity ward in a project in South Sudan. So we did all of our labor and delivery in one of these tents, and then any emergency obstetrical care, so C-sections in a tent adjoining this one. Generally, none of these buildings have air conditioning. A busy maternity ward, so kind of you can see there's a nice tile floor, but we've got three laboring moms at this moment in time, so busy project. And then a very different and small project where you have two delivery beds in a small hut with a canvas ceiling, so kind of a makeshift hut, and a mosquito net that we used actually as a pole rope for women who were in squats while they were delivering their babies. So one of the biggest jobs that you probably would have as a midwife working for us is management of your staff, but also teaching. Something that I find to be a really great joy in working for Doctors Without Borders or MSF So this was following a class that I was teaching just on fetal development to the traditional birth attendants that ran this Ministry of Health maternity ward. So in this case, none of the midwives that we had were formally trained. So a lot of basic skills that they were learning, and also a lot of dedication to their local population, but also a lot of tricks up their sleeves that you might not think of coming from the West. A lot of what you might be doing is management. So there are two midwives here doing prenatals and postpartum visits for the mothers, and a lot of what you're doing is providing oversight and some education and making sure that the medical supplies are available, but you might not actually be doing very much hands-on patient care, which can be challenging for a lot of volunteers coming to MSF, but I think it's really important that that's something that you're aware of before you volunteer with us, is that it's possible that you won't be putting hands on very many patients. What you will most likely do a lot of is teaching. So here we have a class on sterile technique, and on the right-hand side, teaching about suturing vaginal tears, and then in the bottom, teaching about manual vacuum extraction for contained placental parts or fetal parts. And this is a larger class of midwives and also outreach workers that we did on response for survivors of sexual and gender-based violence. And sometimes you get a beautiful normal delivery. So complications that you might see in the field, and certainly good complications to be familiar with, skills that we need in our midwives. So experience doing breech deliveries, twins, or triplets, or quadruplets even, VBACs, shoulder dystocias, I have seen a lot of in the field. Postpartum hemorrhage is very common and often impacted by severe anemia and also malaria, which can also cause a lot of preterm deliveries. Vacuum extraction, so vacuum deliveries, being comfortable providing abortions, but also providing response to unsafe abortions, neonatal resuscitation, assisting in cesarean sections, being comfortable with destructive deliveries, and also responding to sexual violence or post-rape care. So on the left-hand side, this is a breech delivery that I did in Ethiopia. So the baby was 4.5 kilos, so approximately 10 pounds. Beautiful breech vaginal delivery. It's pretty common in some areas for you to be the one who's on call for the complicated deliveries, and then to teach your staff how to manage those complications where they are skilled and comfortable doing normal deliveries. And on the right-hand side is a set of triplets. This was actually vaginal quadruplets that we had, and one of them didn't survive. And in comparison to that beautiful 10-pound or 4.5 kilo breech delivery, this was like approximately 1 kilo preterm baby that we had. In my first mission, I lost a baby every day, and I lost a mom every week. We did approximately 400 deliveries a month. So being comfortable with the death of a mother and certainly the death of newborns, where the death of a fetus is incredibly important if you want to work in these contexts, and making sure that you have good coping skills and good stress management skills for yourself. It's not easy to lose mothers and babies. So one thing I also would like to say is that it's very common to have an increased number of miscarriages in the field, or also complications from unsafe termination of pregnancy. So being comfortable with terminating pregnancies yourselves, but also knowing how to effectively respond to any of those complications and provide emotional support to mothers and families is an important part of your job as a midwife in the field. Often you are the only one doing that kind of care. It can be unsafe in certain contexts for the national staff to respond to those specific needs of the mothers. And when my last mission in Papua New Guinea and a couple of missions in South Sudan, Ethiopia, a lot of what I ended up doing was working in our sexual gender-based violence programming. I treated a lot of women and counseled a lot of women, but also did a lot of education in the community and with our staff and how to properly respond to violence towards women. So that meant talking to the local leaders, it meant going into the schools and talking to students and educators. So your scope as a midwife may be a lot more expansive than you originally thought. There's opportunities to learn a lot and to teach a lot. And that's, I guess, that's it for me.
Great. Thank you, Erin. There were a few good questions that came in.
Derek,
do you mind taking a few now, and then
Absolutely.
We can get to more later?
Sure. So Joy is asking, as a midwife in the States, it's very possible to go on an entire career without losing a mother or newborn. How do you cope with high maternal infant mortality rates?
Your team is generally in, you know, similar situations with their patients as well, so there's a lot of team support and opportunities to talk about loss. We have medical reference that you can call and ask about complicated cases and what you might want to do for those cases. I think it's important to remember that you're not here to learn how to do something for the first time, that if you've never, for example, done a breech delivery, this might not be the time to go and learn how to do breeches, but your medical reference, your medical coordinator are also available to help you learn some of those skills or to coach you in how you should respond, and they're also available to you to talk about difficult cases. I did personally a lot of journaling and blogging, and talked a lot with my staff about what our emotional experiences were following difficult deliveries, but also what our technical experiences were, so that we could learn from them. I think that, you know, MSF shouldn't be the first time you shouldn't be who you go overseas with for the first time. I think it's really important to go to smaller projects and programs that aren't so intensive to gain some of those experiences about how the rest of the world lives before you join us.
We have two questions about what is a destructive delivery.
Destructive delivery is when the baby is obstructed, so the baby is not coming out easily. Generally, that means that the baby has already passed away, so it's an internal uterine death. And in order to save the mother's life, often because you have no access to a cesarean section, you might not have a surgeon in that project, the nearest hospital where they can perform surgery may be too far for a mother to travel, and the risk of her dying in that process is too great. Or you could have be in an area where the armed conflict is preventing you from sending a mother to the nearest hospital, and in that case then you remove the you might have to remove the fetus, the demised fetus, in parts, usually by collapsing the fetal head, so the cranium, in order to get the baby out to save the mother's life.
Thank you.
Cool. There are a couple more, but we can also take those later.
Okay. Yeah, we'll do one more.
Yeah, we'll do one more. How about that? Sure. So, there are a couple questions here about how did you learn to do abortions, since this is often not part of the education, midwifery education.
How did you learn what?
How to do abortions. I learned in not with MSF, but with a different organization that I worked with for a while before applying to MSF. I was taught by an obstetrician how to do termination of pregnancy, both medically, so you know, using medication, but also manually. So I learned how to do DNC, and I also learned how to do an MVA, or a manual vacuum extraction.
Sure.
Hi everyone, my name is Margaret. I'm one of the Women's Health Reference for the MSF. I just also like to add on to what Ellen said, is that we have very clear guidelines and protocols that we use in the field that is written by people like myself based on evidence-based data, research, and also very context-specific, because obviously things you might do in your hospital here in the US will be different to how you might do it in Sudan. So we don't often expect people often to have experience in every single thing as a midwife coming from countries like the US or Australia, where I come from, which is why we have very clear protocols and guidelines for people to follow that are very easy to follow, that explain how to do procedures. Having said that, we would only expect you to do a procedure that you hadn't done before under the supervision of an obstetrician gynecologist in the field. Some of the medical procedures, such as the medical termination of pregnancy, we could be happy for a midwife to do that, if as long as midwife is very clear on how to estimate gestation, etc., and the guidelines that we write are very clear on how to do those procedures. So that's just another thing that you have available to you in the field.
Thank you, Margaret. That's great. Margaret is a guest of ours who's sitting in. She's a Australian midwife, and she works in Australia, as she said, as a reference. So she's an expert. She's an MSF expert on midwifery. So we might get some of your opinions later on too, that you can help answer some questions. I know you all probably have a lot of other questions, but I might be able to answer some of them in the next few slides, and then we'll try and get to everybody's question as well. I just want to talk a little bit about the recruitment process, because that's what we're here for, hopefully, is to make you into field workers. You see here just a quote about flexibility. Erlyn talked about this. Everything changes from one day to the next all the time in the field with MSF, and you need to, I guess there's no way of really being prepared for whatever could happen, but it takes a certain amount of flexibility and adaptability to be able to adapt to life in the field and to the working conditions or the complexities that may arise in the field as well. So you're going to see that here when I talk about general requirements. And this is what we're kind of looking for out of everyone. We'll get a little bit more into the specifics of midwives. But generally, we expect everyone to be flexible and available. When we're talking about availability, we're talking about 9 to 12 months for the first month, for the first assignment, sorry. So, and at least 2 years of relevant professional experience, so post your training. other general requirements, ability to work with an international team. So this sounds a lot easier than it is, I think. A lot of people say, oh, I love people, I love working with teams, no problem. Let me tell you that this is the number one reason why we don't have too many missions that end early, but if a mission does end early, this is the number one reason why. You have to imagine yourself living, breathing, sleeping, eating, working 24/7 in a very hot, very stressful, very potentially claustrophobic scenario with the same group of people day in and day out, right? People who have very different cultural habits than yours, people who have different, speak different languages, people who have different bathing habits, people who have different smoking habits. It's much more complicated than it sounds, and it takes a certain personality, and I think you need to ask yourself if you can do that for 9 to 12 months. Relevant travel or work in developing countries. Of course, we're not talking about a cruise to Antigua here. I'd like to see on your CV or on your application, as Erlen talked about, working in a developing country, hopefully, maybe with a smaller NGO or something before you've come to MSF. But it's not necessary, it's not a requirement to have that work. If not, we'd like to have seen that you're at least a world traveler. You've been uncomfortable in your travels, you've challenged yourself, you have traveled off the grid a little bit, and that's something to highlight on your application as well. Of course, excellent communication skills, managing, teaching, training. Erlen went into this already and talked about the importance of it. This is the legacy that you're leaving on the country or on the in the project in where you're working. So handing over your skills to develop other midwives is an essential part of what we do. In fact, at least with physicians and nurses, we talk about only 30 to 40% of your job being direct patient care. A big portion of the work is coaching, training, teaching other staff how to develop their skills. Computer skills, commitment to MSF principles, of course. Age requirements, as I said before, there are none. Well, 18 is the minimum. I've placed people in the field as old as 78, 79. And I put couples up here because people ask all the time, and actually we don't recruit couples, at least not for the first mission. Sometimes there are exceptions much further down the road as you become a much more experienced MSFer and you're willing to commit to some long-term assignments in the field, but not at first. And foreign language skills is a major, major asset. And what are we talking about here? Mostly French. And this is why. So you see that three of our five largest projects are in French-speaking countries. And actually, I think the sixth largest project is Haiti. So four out of six are French-speaking countries. Over 55% of our vacancies, our positions in the field, are French-speaking positions. So it's essential. We're talking about conversational French here, right? So the reading and writing is not so important. We use the European grading system, so A1, A2, B1, B2. And we're really looking for people B2 and above. But if you've shown a commitment, if you're already at an A2 or a B1, you can start working on this. You can do an immersion yourself. It's the kind of thing you can quickly maybe get yourself to a B2 level if you're a quick learner, and then that makes you eligible to work in some of these French-speaking contexts. And it makes you a much more, let's say, placeable expatriate. So we can find jobs for you more quickly, more frequently if you speak French. It's just a very large need. Arabic is the other one today on the rise, so we're often looking for Arabic speakers as well to work in some of our Middle Eastern contexts. So not a requirement French, but a major asset. This is quickly just to show you a snapshot of the application process, give you a little bit of a time frame of how it works. You're already at number three, that's us, an info session. So the next step, if you feel you're ready, would be, well, go to our website first, read through all the real specific requirements, make sure you're ready, and then apply online. Your application would then be screened. You would possibly be invited for a phone screening. If that goes well, you could be invited for an in-person interview in New York. And if that goes well, you could be invited for a training or a three-day briefing session in New York where we kind of welcome you to MSF. Then you enter into our pool. So if you don't know this already, we don't recruit by specific vacancy. like you would for a job in the U.S., apply for a specific job. We're recruiting into a pool, a pool of field workers here for in the U.S. that we like to keep as diverse as possible. So lots of different profiles, different skills, people with different availability at different time frames, language skills, and so forth. This way, because we don't know what the next crisis is going to be that we're going to have to respond to in 6 months, a diverse pool gives us the flexibility to be able to place people in assignments and respond to crises as they come up. This can take some time, though. Once you're in your pool, this is sort of where we say congratulations, you've been accepted into the MSF pool, but now don't quit your day job and don't sell your house, because it could take a little while to find you an assignment. Actually, average waiting time in our pool in the U.S. is about 3.5, maybe four months. That's average. Some people wait a lot longer until they can find their first assignment. Some people, things come up right away. And this is where French really kicks in. If you're a French speaker, it's probably a lot quicker, but we can find you an assignment. And that's the matching process. So the whole thing generally takes about 3 to 4 months. It's a long recruitment process. We try to expedite it as much as we can. But you should allow yourself, I like to say, allow yourself 6 months before you're available to apply. So if you're available, so where are we now, in July, and you think you're thinking about doing a mission with MSF, or you'd like to in January, you should start looking to apply now. It could take 3 or 4 months to get through this process. And then the reason why the matching process can take some time, like I said, the waiting period in the pool, is because it's quite competitive. There are 28 other MSF sections out there. And this is the way it works. So for instance, an operational center in Amsterdam would open a position and let us know if they've got a vacancy for a field nurse, let's say it's a midwife in this case, in Central African Republic in Carnot. The midwife needs to be French-speaking. They need to be available to leave in 2 weeks. So we would look into our pool in the U.S. and say, oh, I've got the perfect person. Let me call Erilyn, for example, and see if she's willing to accept this assignment. So we make a match, right, like basic job placement. But, of course, 27 other sections are doing the same thing, and they're proposing their great people to the OC, to the operations center, sorry. And so the operations center will choose which candidate, which staff member they like best. Hence, it can be very competitive and take some time. Benefits. So a lot of people have questions about what we pay, or if you get paid, you do. You see, we cover round-trip transportation. Room and board, of course, is provided. The starting salary is $1,913 per month. That is an indemnity level for the first 12 months of your time in the field, and then it increases with experience. It's actually pretty good, because when you're in the field, you get per diem as well. And per diem is usually more than enough to live off of in the field. So the $1,913 per month goes straight into your bank account back in the U.S. And if you go to the field for, say, 12 months, you come home from the field and you've got 12 times, it's almost $24,000 in your bank account, right? Plus you have health insurance. So health, dental, vision as well. It's covered, of course, during your assignment. But then we have here in the U.S., we have a three-month tail. So when you come back to the U.S., it's an extension. You will still be covered for health, dental, and vision for an extra 3 months after you've returned from your mission. So you've got hopefully $25,000 in the bank, and you've got 3 months of health insurance. You've got time now to recover from your mission. You don't have to go right back to work to figure out what your next move is going to be, to rest, hopefully to rest and prepare for another assignment with MSF. Of course, 401k plan, additional emergency coverage refers to medevac insurance, so we will medevac you in the field if you get sick. 25 vacation days for every 12 months. It basically works out to about a week every 3 months you're in the field. So most people are requested to take a week off every 3 months in the field. A lot of people, if you're in Africa, they'll go to the beach in Zanzibar, but you're also, a lot of people will meet up with family in Europe or even fly themselves all the way back to the U.S. So about every 3 months, you get a vacation and you can see your loved ones during that time. In-house financial planning consultant, access to psychosocial care support, and student loans. We don't have we're revamping our in-house repayment program, but we do qualify for the U.S. federal public repayment program. So this is, I was going to try and talk a little bit, and this is off the cuff, of about recruitment and requirements and what we're really looking for when we're recruiting midwives here in the U.S. I can tell you that we do recruit CPMs, CNMs, and CMs as well. We are in, here in the U.S., we recruit all of them. We do information sessions like this one. We do a lot of social media work. We travel around the country doing events for midwives. I can tell you we do some of our best recruiting for midwives on, in the Pacific Northwest, which is where Ireland is from. We also, a lot of our midwives come from the southwest of the U.S. We struggle in other places to find midwives, to encourage them to apply to MSF. A lot of it has to do with the requirements. We realize it's a large commitment of 9 to 12 months. We're looking for people to build careers with MSF. We're looking to build retention with MSF. A lot of it has to do with background and training. Where are you going to get the kind of experiences in the U.S.? Where are you going to get the kind of, see the kind of complicated cases and things like that? I don't know, Margaret and Erlyn can probably talk more about this. I mean, Margaret, you see a ton of different midwives with different backgrounds in terms of what you're looking for in their experience.
Look, I think one of the main things is that people have recent experience in delivery and in managing complicated cases. So whether that's in the hospital system or in a more of a community role, but you need to have experience in those cases and how to manage them, and then in managing complicated deliveries. I'm not so sure with the US system, and I can add to that, but I know, say, in Australia, for example, we often suggest to our midwives to go and work in remote areas where there aren't as many doctors fighting for those deliveries, where you actually will be the one to do that, unexpected breach delivery, etc. So, of course, a lot of our projects, as Ellen has alluded to in her presentation, we deal with the complications. The world, the normal deliveries often don't come. We'd like them to, and sometimes they do, but we do deal with a lot of complications, and having that experience already makes you obviously much more skilled for the field.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so. Along those lines of where else to go to get those experiences within the US, so there are birth centers like Maternidad de Luz that are more remote, that are also very busy. We like midwives that come out of that area specifically, but you're also more likely to see complications. I know midwives who have gone and volunteered with smaller midwifery organizations in the Philippines and Haiti, going in, working closer to the reservations, if possible, working with some of the birth centers in Alaska. Those places will give you access to the experiences that you are going to need in the field, but also show MSF that you're comfortable living in remote settings,
yeah,
in uncomfortable settings.
What about IHS?
IHS can be a little complicated because IHS won't always take CPMs. I think IHS will take CMs, which mostly are coming out of the East Coast.
So it's
a little different than West Coast CPMs. But also, even for nurse midwives, if if you're working in a hospital context in the U.S., you're not so likely to do vaginal breaches because the obstetrician is doing that or it's going straight to a C-section. Go and work in one of the states where vaginal breaches and vaginal twins is still legal and volunteer at one of the birth centers that's busy in Salt Lake City.
And a CNM can do that as well.
And
right?
A CNM can do that, a CPM can do that, and a CM can do that.
Yeah. Great.
And I guess being one of the people that actually validates the CVs and skills lists that people's applicants send to us, we will look for, how much experience is required in this area before you go away. Yes, so the skills list you would fill out, and then myself and two other colleagues will be validating them. So we like to see at least a year, if not 2 years, certainly 2 years post-grad for sure, but at least 12 to 2 years experience in these delivery settings and with these complicated cases that, that Alan has alluded to. Sometimes, of course, with things like probably saying breech or things like manual vacuum aspiration, we don't expect you to have 2 years of that because you won't do that in the US, but we at least like you to have done that procedure under supervision, if possible, a couple of times.
So one of the things that you are asked to fill out when you apply is this obstetrical skills list, and I apologize that it says obstetrical skills because some of these things are midwife skills and we're not OBs.
But the reason is that both obs guides and midwives got the same one, just to make it easy.
But some of the things on this list, obviously, as a midwife, you are not going to have experience with, and nor would they expect you to. So don't be so dissuaded by, you know, anesthesia management. But if you've seen a couple of C-sections as, you know, a midwife who's transferred care, make sure that you include that. The more that you've seen or read about or experienced, the better it is to understand what your profile is, how you might manage the stress of some of those complications. I think that, you know, talking about some complications that might not be listed here that also show that you're comfortable, you know, losing a mother, you're comfortable losing a baby, if you've had a stillbirth in your own practice, those are really important things to talk about. As part of what we're looking for, obviously, is the technical skills of all of these pieces, but also that you have the stress management skills to handle things when the going gets tough.
And I think just to add to that, that yes, this is a little bit confusing because it is obs, gyns and midwives on the same skills list. So as a midwife, we would not expect you to actually tick that you have done a C-section or a forceps, because we know that in most contexts that is not in midwifery training. So therefore, if you've actually done it, we might be slightly concerned to think, why are you doing something outside of the midwifery scope of practice? So I hope it's not confusing you. So I guess I'm just trying to reiterate what Ellen said, is that not all this is going to be relevant to you. It's what is in your scope of practice from your training that and what you've done afterwards that we'd like to see.
Yeah.
You referenced one or two places where you can gain this experience. Do you mind just repeating those a little bit? Lots of questions around.
I don't remember what the name of the hospital is in the Philippines, but there is a midwife training program very specific to midwives in the Philippines. There's midwives for Haiti in Haiti. There's Mama Baby Haiti. That's a birth center in the northern part of Haiti. Maternidad de Luz, which is, I believe, it's in Texas in the U.S. There are some busy birth centers in Alaska that are constantly needing extra help and support, and obviously more remote, so the likelihood that you would get experience doing twins or breaches or other malpresentations is a lot higher than possibly in a busy city in the States. There are a couple of birth centers in Bali, I believe. There's the International Circle of Midwives, I believe it's called. There are some Facebook pages about volunteer midwives that are needed in Uganda and Senegal, more Western African countries where conflict isn't so great, some more secure contexts that we aren't working in, but they still need support of midwives. Those can be good places to go spend some time and get a little uncomfortable and gain some skills.
That's great. So we'll put together a list of some of those things that you mentioned, and as we email the registrants of the webinar, maybe we'll include some of them, and so folks can take a look at that
as well. I mean, I think one of the other pieces that is also very beneficial is the also.
Yes.
Is the also
That's
course,
right.
And maybe Margaret can talk a little bit about that, but the also, I don't know what the website is, but the also training happens all over the US fairly frequently, actually. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty easy to find a course, you know, in within your time frame or near you, depending on what your preferences are. I believe it's around $600. And they go through complicated cases quite specifically. It's a simulation course, so you get essentially hands-on practice, you know, doing shoulder dystocias, doing postpartum hemorrhages, doing complicated deliveries like breaches. And that is a useful thing for us to see that you have been through that training.
Yeah, absolutely. The Advanced Life Support Obstetrics is what it stands for also. So yeah, absolutely, really good. Because I think the thing is that if there's a couple of procedures you haven't done, such as a vacuum, for example, or an MVA, and they're the only two procedures as a midwife that you haven't done, but you have experience in managing PPHs and managing short dystocias, we would possibly accept you and send you to a project where there is an obstetrician gynecologist who could then, you know, teach you those two other skills. So doing the also course beforehand gives you the background in those techniques that you may not have had. So, you know, we don't want to exclude everybody that hasn't done anything, but we do really want you to at least have a couple of years trying to get those experiences, and certainly with the medical management of complications, absolutely for sure.
I think you have to remember that, so a lot of the places where I've suggested there are other midwives that are there, there's obstetricians, there's access to C-sections, so you're not the end of the line. And a lot of the projects that MSF is likely to send you on, you are the end of the line. There is no obstetrician. I spent 9 months in a program where I really couldn't transport any of my mothers. So if I couldn't manage that complication, that was it. And, you know, so 1 year wrestling with that, but also, you know, the program and the organization, we want to know that you can handle those complications, but also you want to know that you can handle those complications, because when someone walks in and they've got nowhere else to go and you don't know how to comfortably do twin deliveries or a shoulder dystocia or a vacuum extraction, it's not going to sit so well with you yourself.
Good. That's great. We're going to take your questions now. Any questions, if they're related to recruitment or what we've been talking about, would be great. We'll just go on for a little bit more. Let me put up a slide here that, let's skip that, shall we? Go right to the questions. I'm just going to put up a slide which gives you the, there we go. Just some relevant details. So listen, you can always email us afterwards, after this evening, event.rsvp@msf.org. If you have specific questions about your case and your skills and you want, you know, to get some feedback and things like that, I recommend you save it. And now we talk more generally, so we can sort of talk to the whole group. But you can always email us at that address. And then, of course, doctorswithoutborders.org, work in the field, is where you can find out more information about how to apply and then actually go through if you're ready to apply and become a field worker. But there were just some more questions that came up that were interesting there for Erlen. Yeah. Do you mind just reading it for us? I'll pull these up.
Sure. Joy is asking, what is the retention rate for midwives? Have you worked with same group midwives, and what is the community of midwives like with MSF?
So it doesn't really work quite like that. Most of the missions I've been in, I was the only midwife. So I generally don't see the, generally don't see the other midwives that are in the pool unless we're at a training or, you know, some special event. And I have been fortunate enough actually to be back in some of the projects that I was at early on in my MSF career, but I think that that's not necessarily so common. So you may spend 9 months in one project and get attached to your midwives that you're working with that are the local staff, and you may never see them again, which can be really hard, honestly. But yeah.
Overall, we do retention very well. We put, I've talked about the benefits that we offer, the increase in salary, the kind of repayment programs and things like that. Generally, I think worldwide, MSF does about 50% retention. We do a little bit higher in the U.S. I think 65% of our expatriates will, our international staff will go on at least a second mission. It tends to decline a little bit after a third mission and a fourth mission and come down to, especially for medical profiles. And I don't know exactly how it relates to midwives, but we put a lot of care and concentration into the retention of our staff.
I think the U.S. pool of midwives actually has pretty good retention.
Yeah.
And the midwives that were around when I joined for the most part
are still around. Yes, we love you.
There's a good core group of us that are still here and are happy to work with you, welcome you.
And then, of course, if you get lots of experience, you can become someone like me.
Except you never leave, so I can't.
I'm hustling,
So, Erlyn, do you also work in private practice? How do you balance your work here with your time away?
So, I had a private practice, and when I decided that I was going to go work with MSF and it became pretty clear that I was going to be accepted, I closed that practice and I haven't opened it since. I think I've done 6 missions, and wanting to continue with those missions, it's really impossible to have a private practice unless you have a group of midwives that are willing to close those gaps. As a home birth midwife in Portland, Oregon, that's just not possible. You can't be gone for 9 months and come home and expect to pick up your practice. So it was a conscious choice for me.
Molly is asking, is making a comment, sleep is an ongoing issue for midwives. So the question is, what is sleeping like in the field?
I get it.
Hello, Molly. If you're with Molly, I think you are welcome. But really hard. In summer programs, you may be the only midwife, so you're on call 24/7. So you could have very skilled national staff that are capable of, you know, managing most everything that walks in the door, but that doesn't mean that they're not going to need help in the middle of the night and need help in the middle of the night every night for your 6 months in the field. If the volume of patients is high enough and the complications are high enough, we generally carry with us radios both for security purposes but also because you are on call. Or telephones. So national staff midwives, or if you're lucky enough to have an obstetrician, you can call each other. So you can take a break, take Sunday off maybe, and have someone just radio you if there's a complication and they need some support. My first mission, I happened to have an obstetrician and another midwife. So every third night I was the first on call, and every second night I was second on call, and then every third night I only got called in if for some reason we felt like we needed the three of us as a team. So part of I think part of the commitment that you're making and part of that flexibility and that adaptability is that you are generally sleep deprived, exhausted. There's not a lot of food. It's food that you might not be used to eating. Sometimes there's nowhere to go. There's no, there's no movie theater. There's no mall. So it can be really challenging. It also is incredibly rewarding.
Great. I would also recommend folks to go back onto some of these other questions. There's some great resources that other people have written in. So that's great that you guys are engaging. We have a question about safety in the field, a common question for recruitment.
Do you
speak to that?
Well, I can tell you a little bit generally, and maybe Erlyn can talk about her specific experiences, but MSF takes security very, very, very seriously and does it very well. I'm not going to go into it in full detail right now. As you go through the process, you would, of course, get full security briefings. You would understand how the security is done. You would then get briefed on the security of your context and security briefings by your head of mission and by your medical coordinator and so forth. In a nutshell, there's a clear chain of command. There are very strict protocols. If you stick to the protocols, generally you will be safe. The number one rule to remember is that if you ever feel unsafe, you can just go home. But the way MSF does it very quickly is it's a lot of communication on the ground, as I talked about. It's a lot of awareness. It's a lot of meetings. It's a lot of talking about who we are. And really, it's about the quality of our medical programs. And that's the number one, I think, way that we provide security. So
when the general, right, when the Army general of the community, mm-hmm. his wife is pregnant, she's coming to you to deliver mm-hmm. her baby with,
exactly.
your midwife staff. And that relationship actually creates a lot of safety in the field.
Yeah. Did you ever have any issues? Did you ever feel unsafe, or did you
We did a birth in the field, actually, that was really complicated, and had it was actually the first time that I called my medical referent for advice, and the situation that we were in was very, very complicated, but ultimately, for some reason, the husband and his family thought that we had done a C-section on this mother that we hadn't done surgery on. And my life and the obstetrician I was working with, our lives were threatened. So we were immediately evacuated out of the field, and the project coordinator or the field coordinator, so the person that's kind of in charge of the whole program on the ground and our safety, then spent a lot of time talking to the family, but then also to the local community, because of course in those small villages often the word spreads quickly.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes it's a lot of damage control.
But it's really about trust, and we build up the trust of these communities, and they know who we are, and they see our faces, and they know us personally, and they know what we're doing there, and then we've treated their cousin, we've treated their friends, and they see people get better. They see people that are sick, and I've seen it in Haiti, and go into an MSF clinic and come out better, and this spreads throughout a community, and you build that relationship. And some of these places MSF has been for 20, 30 years as well.
Interestingly, in that same project, I went back, I don't know, maybe a year later, 14 months later, something like that, and was walking, had been back for a couple of days and was walking through the market and had numerous women come up to me and say, "You are my midwife, you helped deliver the baby. Oh, it's Erlyn, she's in the village again." Like everyone, you spend enough time in the community,
really
they get to know you, and that definitely contributes to your safety. which goes into, there was a question, Henry, about other care that you provide.
Yeah, so Claire is asking, as a midwife with MSF, do you provide gyn care in addition to OB care?
So the answer is yes, absolutely. A lot of what we do is prenatal counseling, prenatal education, doing outreach into the villages or into the community, talking about breastfeeding, talking about proper hygiene, talking about coming in for treatment of sexual violence, just general basic prenatal care, postpartum and newborn care, and also then family planning. So in most projects, there are there's access to a couple of different kinds of family planning. I have taught classes to the community about general menstruation to the girls in schools, but what is the menstrual cycle? How do you get pregnant? How do you prevent getting pregnant? And there are projects where you might not do very many deliveries, but you might end up actually doing a lot more community outreach, talking about all of those other aspects. We have some programs now where we're doing more screening for cervical cancer, vaccinations for HPV, adolescent sexual reproductive health. So, your role as a midwife could vary greatly. And it's possible that you would only do a handful of deliveries a month. My last project in Papua New Guinea, actually, I was there for 9 months and I only delivered one baby.
Wow.
Mostly it was sexual donor-based violence response, but still, we did family planning, we did all sorts of other things, but I only did one delivery.
Good, a couple more? Okay.
Yeah.
Sure. There are a couple questions in here to kill a couple of birds with one stone. There are a couple questions about years of experience and how that is validated and how many years of experience is needed for a midwife.
So I think it's the same thing. You need 2 years after you finish your training.
That's right.
2 years clinical practice in your relevant professions, that would be midwifery. Then, if those 2 years, as I mentioned earlier, have been in working with women with complications and complicated deliveries, then that 2 years would most likely validate you on that. If, however, those first 2 years weren't in that area, we then expect you to have at least another year working in those complicated areas on top of that. So that, in general, is how it works. Of course, the more experience, the more well placed you would be. But at a minimum.
To learn more about what it's like working in the field, Michelle is asking, would you be willing to share a link to the blog you mentioned, or are there other blogs, MSF blogs, that you can share?
Did you? I don't know.
Yeah, you did. When you said how do you cope, and you said you write your journal.
Oh, I wrote a blog.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, my blog is locked. It's private. So if you want my blog, you have to email me and let me know who you are. Then I'll approve you to read it. But
MSF has.
I'm happy to do that if you can figure out.
We do great field blogs on our website, and there's probably a midwife or two live blogging right now as we speak. So. You see here, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, blogs.msf.org. You can go on now, you can find about people, their daily life they're blogging about right now in South Sudan or whatnot. I find it really interesting reading. I do it all the time for fun. So it's a good question.
It's also a good place to just learn what it's like to actually live and work in the field, regardless of what your professional background is. So much of what is... stressful, honestly, about being in the field is the environment and the other staff that you're living and working with, and a lot less the actual work that you are doing. Mm-hmm. And that you can get from any blog you read.
Mm-hmm. Working with an international team.
Yeah.
One more.
Make it a good one.
Pressure. Let's see here. Many of them revolve around lots of the topics that we talked about, where to get experience, what is considered experience. Maybe one that touches on a couple things we talked about. Joy is asking another question. What percentage of MSF midwifery sites have surgical support, either OB or general?
I don't know what the percentage is, but so I have been in 6 missions, but I've been in about 18 projects, actually. So I've been the midwife in, yeah, around 18 different projects, and I'm pretty certain that I only had an obstetrician in 3 of them.
So, yeah, currently for the operation center of Paris, because I don't want to complicate life, but there's 5 big operational centers in Europe that run MSF projects. So the operational center Paris, I think in 2016 we had 26 projects, and I recall about 18 of those had surgical capacities that had Oxgan present, which is quite large actually, because they'll be a lot of the big tertiary hospitals. But that was just for 2016. That will change year by year depending on the need and what context we're in and the need of that context. So
And OCP, so the general section is more surgical in general than the other than the other 4 sections.
So I guess the answer to that is it really depends on the context, you know, and where we are and what.
I think if that's the question of, you know, for your own personal comfort, I think that it's wise to not. To just assume that you won't have you won't have another midwife, you won't have a surgeon, and you may or may not have a doctor who's ever even done a delivery. And my first mission, we did 400 deliveries a month. We were incredibly busy. We had an obstetrician. The OBs were generally there for six weeks to 3 months. But not all of the obstetricians that I had ever even done. You know, I had an obstetrician that I taught how to do reach vaginal delivery. She's never done that.
Yeah.
She's only ever done C-sections. So,
I think the other thing is, though, that we do try wherever possible, that if we don't have the capacity for surgery or someone should do C-sections, we do try to access a referral centre. So whether that be Ministry of Health in that country or sometimes another NGO, we will try and find somewhere we can refer. Sometimes that often may not be possible for the reasons that Alex has alluded to earlier, just conflict security, geography, but it's not like we don't deliberately leave you out there. We do try and find those referral centres, but on occasions that... it's easier than other occasions.
Mm-hmm. And you know, and Margaret is here, and she's one of the medical reference. So, you know, if you encountered a complication and you didn't know what to do, she would be one of the people that you would call, and they're very responsive. And in some programs, MSF also has access to telemedicine. So there's, you know, there's also other means of getting support. And you mentioned the obstetrics guideline, the book, the purple book.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's references and guides and materials in every project that you've been in. And often you have national staff that are incredibly experienced and sometimes way more experienced than you are.
Yeah. They're often your best asset, aren't they?
Yeah.
National staff.
Yeah, for sure. And your best friends.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Well, thank you, everybody, for your questions and your engagement. If you have more questions, please feel free to email the address on your screen, which is right here, event.rsvp at msf.org. And we will, in the next, in the coming days, try to respond to all of your individual questions that you might have. I want to thank Erlyn, I want to thank Margaret, I want to thank Doug. It's been great to have all the knowledge that you bring to the table here, and I hope that we've inspired a couple of you guys. I know I was, so.
Yeah, thanks everybody for tuning in. Doctorswithorders.org/work in the field. You'll see a lot more information about the things we've talked about today, but then also how to apply and become a field worker. I'm just going to leave you with a video. Oh no. It's only 90 minutes long, so you don't, 90 seconds long, sorry, 90 minutes. It's 90 seconds long, so you don't have to stay and watch the whole thing. But I always find it really inspiring, and we'll just say goodbye after this. So
thanks
so much.
You.
Thanks for joining us. And hopefully we'll see you in the field.
Avec les gens, donc ça pointille, ça augmente ma passion pour ce travail.
The work here gives a lot of meaning to my job, which I don't find anywhere else.
Vous ne pouvez pas imaginer la joie que j'ai de voir quelqu'un que j'ai récupéré mourant sortir de l'hospitalisation.
C'est, je ne sais pas, après c'est un travail qui me comble. Hein. Professionnellement et personnellement aussi. Je changerai pour bien longtemps.
J'ai trouvé de la passion, tout simplement. Je me lève le matin, je suis content de ce que je fais, j'ai envie, j'ai la courage, j'ai la pêche.
C'est ce que j'ai voulu faire. J'ai rêvé de ça et maintenant je suis en train de le faire.
Même pas un ONG.